As at December 2014, we have a total prisoner population of 15,014 in our custody. The capacity of our prisons in this country can hold only 9,875.
There are nearly 3,000 remand inmates in Ghana's prisons. Some have been locked up for years.
The large numbers of our prison inmates are those on remand. A number of them have expired warrants. Indeed, some of them have spent more years on remand than would have suffered if they had been convicted on the offenses they have been charged with. Why do we put people on remand for so long, denying them of their freedom? Is this the justice we want for our country?
I'm 28 years.
Okay, where do you come from?
I come from Accra.
Accra?
Yeah.
Okay. For how long have you been here?
4 years. No police station, no court.
Why?
I don't know. Since my CI bring us for here, you no come back.
He said
4 years.
Judges and police prosecutors are greatly blamed for this.
Some are charged with things that are not offenses, or offenses that have been created by the police themselves. This is a country regulated by law. And when it comes to criminal law, offenses must be clearly postulated. They are clearly stated by law. The punishment will know their offenses. But to some extent, you can see that the police will formulate some charges that are not found in any of their statute books.
My name is Seth Kwame Boateng. Today, I am taking you to four of our prisons, Tamale, Sunyani, Kumasi, and Nsawem prisons, to hear the harrowing stories of remand prisoners and how the massive congestion in there makes them live under extremely inhumane conditions. These are people who have been locked and forgotten. From the dark sky above the Kumasi Central Prison emerges a broad sun to announce the arrival of a new day. The doom and gloom of the night give way to light, a symbol of hope. Within the thick walls of the prison, inmates prepare for this new day with songs and prayers, praying fervently for God to intervene in their situation. These prayers are emanating from the 6 cells in the remand block of the Kumasi prisons. No, prayer changes. I heard that prayer changes. I believe that prayer changes. I know that prayer changes things. Prayer changes. I heard that prayer changes. I believe that prayer changes. I know that prayer changes things. Soon, the prayers are over, and it's time for the cells to be opened for the inmates to experience a bit of fresh air after 14 hours of lockup. About 700 remand prisoners are in the Kumasi prisons, and there are just a few places of convenience available. So the opening of the cells comes with a struggle for use of these facilities. It's on a first-come, first-served basis. It's a matter of survival of the fittest. For some inmates here, however, the arrival of a new day comes with no hope. They have been in prison for 3, 4, and 5 years.
Slamo, we hear the Munti and Ayawaha and the day. Die, ye complain. You were quite a bit, ya faso, said the Abeya Mubenyamwa. You were nipa, ye Jumawa, TV station. Ye pressure, obey ye documentary, mammo, and yes, obey ye, one was out. Ye the Enunso Aqua Abaimo, Aqua Tre, atetene ohawa amuwo ama obi nsu ho a pati ase
These are all criminal suspects who have been charged with or are likely to be charged with a criminal offense. They are being held on remand because some have been denied, refused, or unable to meet bail conditions. There are others here because the court has determined that they are at risk of running away before the trial or otherwise a risk to society. Some of the inmates on remand here were arrested for various offenses, smoking Indian hemp, robbery, or a suspected murder case. For now, they remain suspects until they are proven guilty. So being locked for years without trial has over the years been a big worry for governments and lawmakers. Interior Minister Marco Yongo sees this as a complete waste of state resources.
Indeed, government is spending so much on many persons who do not deserve to be in police or prison custody. For me, petty thieves and petty criminals should not be given jail terms, but made to serve in the community.
Each wall in this prison has been carefully designed to hold these people back from the freedom they long for. 45-year-old father of five, Mohammed Abdullahi, is one of the about 700 remand prisoners in the Kumasi Central Prisons. He has been on remand for the past 3 years. Mohammed Abdullahi was arrested on suspicion that he murdered his younger brother, who had just returned from Libya. A criminal defendant has the right to a lawyer at any stage of the criminal process, interrogation, trial, and sentencing. But Mohammed Abdullahi has not had the services of a lawyer since he was arrested 3 years ago. In many jurisdictions, an inmate such as Abdullahi will be offered a lawyer. But that's not the case in Ghana. As much as he's concerned about his case, Abdullahi is constantly thinking about his five children. A father's love is as important to a child's emotional development as a mother's. A cold or distant father can damage a child's life, sometimes for decades to come. Mohammed Abdullahi says he thinks of how bleak his children's future looks and he bursts into tears. I'm going to go to school.
Wind blowing on my face, sidewalk flying beneath my bike.
Mohammed's last child was only 7 months old when he was arrested. But after years in prison, he has no idea how all his 5 children look like now. Mohammed was arrested together with his wife. But I have picked leads that she has been granted bail. So I set out in search of her. She and the husband lived in a small town called Buaman in the Ashanti region. But because of the case, she has relocated to Kumasi to be with her sister. I found her in Ebuakwa, one of Kumasi's suburbs. She is called Gifty Ebua, and she is 24 years old. She has 3 children with her remanded husband. Gifty had her first child when she was 17 years. From afar, Gifty appears to be all well, but when she remembers how she had to spend 1.5 years on remand without her 7-month-old baby, she's unable to hold back her tears.
I was home when some police officers came and requested I go with them to report myself, whether I know something about the case or not. When we got to the police station, they put me at counterback and suggested I stay there till evening for my own safety. They later put me in the cells in the evening and took me to court the next day. In the courtroom, they didn't ask me anything and straight away remanded me. For about 1.5 years, I was on remand until my father used his cocoa farm as a collateral for my bail.
What did the remand say?
It's painful and humiliating leaving her 3 children behind for no one to take care of. With the youngest being only 7 months old and still breastfeeding, her breasts were heavy with milk, on her chest heavy with grief. Her heart desire when she was granted bail was to see her children again after over a year. Unfortunately, her grief doubled when she came home and got the news her 2 elderly children have gone missing since she was arrested.
I wish the government could help me locate my children. Even if I am able to locate them, how to take care of them will be even a problem. I don't have any money anywhere to take care of them, so I wish the government could release my husband so he comes and work and take care of them. At times I pick their pictures and cry. I'm helpless. I have no one to assist me find them.
It is not everybody who is in prison today who has actually offended. Some of them were victims of circumstances and they were not able to put their cases across well. They didn't have lawyers like you are speaking about, you see? Or they may even be illiterate. They may not even understand the proceedings going on. But people like us may have trouble and they will go for the best lawyers and get out scot-free.
The Ghana Prison Service, as a part of the criminal justice system of Ghana, is supposed to contribute to the maintenance of internal security by maintaining an efficient, humane and safe reformatory penal system operated within the laws of Ghana. Human rights lawyer and criminal lecturer at the Gempa Law School, Isidore Tufor, has issues with people being remanded first before investigations are done.
I think that before a person is even arrested and charged
with the commission of a criminal offense. There must be evidence, at least some evidence, to establish a prima facie case. Some evidence to lead to the fact that, yes, the accused person committed the offense. And that must be based on the availability of some amount of evidence in respect of the offense that the accused person is alleged to have committed. So in that case, it reduces it will cut down this trend of appearing before the court, having the person arrested, having the person put on pretrial detention, and telling the court that you are now going for investigations or that investigations are underway. When it happens that way, as a human rights lawyer, the question I ask myself is, what is it that substantiates the fact that you have before you that led you to charge the accused person with the offense if you don't have the evidence? That's the question I ask myself. What is the evidence then? If you are now going to conduct investigations to get evidence and all, then based on what did you charge the accused person? Most especially when the fact you have not even raised any prima facie case.
This may sound controversial, but retired Supreme Court Judge Justice Stephen Alan Brobe is in favor. Justice Brobe, however, says judges cannot be blamed.
We don't get involved in the investigations. We cannot get involved. Our investigations take place inside the court. So if people are arrested and then sent to court with a request that they are going to investigate, it does happen. The judges are aware that this sort of person, you cannot remind him for too long. How long will it take you to investigate if you are not ready? Let the man go off. If they are ready, prosecute. Otherwise, what are you doing? You keep him there unlawfully. It's not, the Constitution says the trial cannot be started within a reasonable time. He's entitled to bail. Then let him go. But to arresting people and going to take a long time to investigate, no, it's not right. And the judges don't usually encourage that.
Listening to the two arguments, it is clear the police service has some questions to answer.
My name is ACP Frankofi. I'm the Director General, Legal and Prosecutions. What it means is that I am the official legal advisor to the Inspector General of Police. And all matters related to legal issues, as it were, are referred to this office for advice. I also supervise all the police prosecutors in this country. He has a case, but his point cannot be wholly true. For example, if you are doing a narcotic case, you have arrested a person with a substance that you suspect is cocaine.
He's talking about misdemeanor cases.
I'm not sure they would throw somebody into remand because of misdemeanor, stealing a petty fowl or a book or fighting in the street. I don't think any judge will throw anybody in prison on remand on misdemeanor cases. Rarely. Most of the cases in the prisons, those on remand, most of them, 95% of them are on unbailable offense cases. Robbery, narcotics, defilement, rape. You can check the records.
Prisons in Ghana are classified based on their level of security and on the activities undertaken at the various establishments. In the central prisons, trade training facilities are provided to equip prisoners with employable skills for their effective reintegration into society. They take custody of long-sentenced prisoners. Local prisons usually keep short-sentenced prisoners. Open camp prisons undertake agricultural activities to provide food and train inmates in modern agricultural practices. Prisoners who are about to be released are at times transferred to these facilities as transit to prepare them for their final release into society. In agricultural settlement camps, the level of security is quite relaxed. They are usually not fenced. The main objective is to train inmates in agricultural activities. There are thousands of people on remand whose cases are still being investigated 7 years on, and they are scattered in prisons across the country. The Tamale Central Prisons in the northern part of Ghana houses a number of such inmates.
Hello. Good morning, sir.
Thank you.
You are most welcome.
Thank you.
To Tamale Central Prison.
Okay.
We have 311 inmates, okay, including 8 female prisoners in safe custody. So you are most welcome.
Thank you. I'm also here to do something on remand prisoners. So this morning, I would need you to help me get to them and speak to them about why they are here, how many years they've been here, and whether they even get to their lawyers. Are they taken to court? What is happening? That's why I'm here.
Okay. For us, it's good news.
Thank you.
And we'll take you around. You'll talk to your remand prisoners, and then maybe get to know their challenges, and then I believe the outcome of it will help them.
Thank you very
so
much.
Please, let's go.
So the Northern Regional Prisons Commander, Assistant Controller of Prisons, Robert Awulugutu, and his officers walk me through this ancient facility built by our colonial masters for other purposes rather than a prison. The air in this prison is completely different, a very pungent cocktail of urine, body odor, heat and stench of filth.
Good morning, sir. Remind prisoners in lawful custody. Permission to carry on, sir.
Carry on. Did you say 8 and 9? 9
and 9 in the morning.
You just call 9 and 9. Okay, 9
and 9. I'm inside the remand block and the air here is worse than the main compound. It is an enclosed area and inmates here are not allowed to step out and mingle with the convict prisoners.
Good morning, everyone. And how are you all? Yes, I can see the smiles on your faces. Yes, today we are very, very lucky. We are highly privileged to have our two gentlemen from Joy News in based in Accra. Their leader is Mr. Set Kwame Boateng. They have come here because of you, the remands.
I am introduced to 40-year-old Halidu Bukari, who is the longest-serving remand prisoner here in the Tamale Central Prisons. Halidu has spent almost 8 years in prison. Justice Stephen Alan Brobe is shocked there are people like Halidu languishing in prison as remand prisoners.
It's mind-boggling to hear that a person has been on remand for 8 years for his case to be investigated. What kind of investigation is that? Even if you were splitting objects into atom components, you would have finished the investigations within 8 years. So if he's there, there must be some reason why he's there. You should ask the prosecutor why he's there. So next time you get there, don't just listen to the prisoners. Ask the prosecutor wherever he is, and you will know the truth. Now, he either hasn't been there for 8 years, or if he's been there for 8 years, there must be a reason why he is there. Yes.
The records there show that he's been there for 8 years.
Yes.
And he alleges again.
And the trial has not started.
The trial has not started. And he alleges again, probably it's because he doesn't have a lawyer.
The state has means of sending people like that to court. So if he has been there for 8 years, then it's one of those systems where the situations where the system that is in place will look into and probably have him released. 8 years is too long a time to keep somebody just to investigate his case.
Halidu is on remand over the death of his 2-year-old daughter. Halidu had a quarrel with his wife, with whom she had 2 children, a 2- and a 5-year-old. Out of anger, both parents left home, but Halidu says his wife rather came home after a week, but without their 2-year-old daughter.
The day that we fight, and he was left in the house, he said that he no take my daughter away. So he don't know where my daughter is. And that day, it was evening when he came back. So before daybreak in the morning, and one of my stepmother go out and he come and reported that he saw something behind near somebody's house. And we go and saw, and there was a corpse.
Little hands.
With that corpse was my daughter.
And little feet, little words, and baby speech.
The loss of a child is the most devastating experience a parent can face, and missing the child never goes away. a piece of yourself is lost and your future is forever changed. The age of the child at the time of death does not lessen the hurt or devastation. It feels completely unnatural for a child to die before his or her parents.
Wondering what to do. A future that seems bleak and far away.
Halidu says anger mixed with sorrow sparked a blame game between himself and his wife, and it triggered some exchanges until the police came in and picked up the two of them. But after 4 days, his wife was freed.
They take me to court and they accuse me, they say that I am the one who killed my daughter. So till 2011, and they brought the case to high court here, and attorney general bring bail of indictment, and inside bail of indictment they say that I intentionally killed my daughter, and they take my father as a witness, my stepmother a witness, my wife as a witness. But since the day they arrested me to today, nobody come to court and witness about anything. And after that, my stepmother, he passed away last 2 years. And the woman himself, me plus him, we separate because I never see him again. And my father too, he always been coming here, but now he don't know how to do, and financially matter, he don't have anything. And he don't know how to do. And I am the one who was taking care of him. So now, how the matter come, truly, I don't know what is going on. And inside the case, if I go to court, the way they are prosecuting me and how they are saying is like something behind the case. And truly, if like I have a person that will stand and go through the case truly, like it will be like maybe like they will free me plus the woman, or they will bring me plus them. But now they turn the case, they are not talking like maybe me plus my wife fight again in court. They say that I intentionally killed my daughter.
Halidu's claim, or if you like, his accusation cannot be independently verified. Yet criminal law lecturer Isidore Tufor confirms at times prosecutors charge people wrongly.
The question that I always ask myself is that, are persons who are suspected to have committed criminal offenses properly charged? That's a question one. Or does it mean that upon a report made by a person or a complaint made by a person, the suspect or the person who is alleged to have committed a criminal offense should be arrested and just be put before court? The police is supposed to first of all go into the facts given to see whether or not there is a charge or that the accused person has committed a criminal offense. To a large extent, they do it, so that you know that the charge that they have against the accused person is one that can be substantiated in court. You have the evidence for that. But in some cases, you can see that blatantly in court, that from the fact read, there's no charge, there is no offense committed by the accused person. But it's somebody who all the same have been marched to court, and he's there. Some are charged with things that are not offenses, or offenses that have been created by the police themselves.
The Director General in charge of legal and prosecutions at the Ghana Police Service, ACP Frank Kofi, however, says this cannot be true.
No, I find it difficult to believe that, because if you go to the police station on any alleged offense, the investigator will ask you to write your own statement. That is the first thing he will tell you to do. He will not write your statement for you. So if you went to steal fowl and you are going to write that you were trading in cocaine, then that is your own problem. But if even a CID or an investigator writes your statement for you, he's going to read over the statement to you to ensure that everything there is correct. And if he doesn't, you can oppose, you can challenge and say that, no, this is not my statement, because what we have written there is not mine, and I'm not going to append my signature or my thumbprint to it. And it is your right to do that. So I will find it difficult to believe that assertion.
Having a parent in prison can have an impact on a child's mental health, social behavior, and educational prospects. The trauma that may occur and the difficulties of a disrupted family life can be compounded by the social stigma that children may face as a result. Children who have an incarcerated parent may experience financial hardship that results from the loss of that parent's income. Khalidu has no idea when he will be set free or convicted. He constantly thinks of how his only 12-year-old child is surviving beyond the walls.
One of my sister, Ide at Tepa Ninesusu, he's the one supported me, come and take, I plead plus, and I said that he should try so that my daughters will go to school. So after that, I hear that last 2 years he came here and he told me that my daughter is going to school. But about 2 years, I never hear about him again.
Okay. How does that make you feel at times?
Concerning my daughter, sometimes if I think about him, I always cry, but I don't want somebody to know that I'm crying. That now, she is my only daughter. Now, I have lost the younger one. And me too, they put me inside remand because I don't have anybody to defend me or talk something concerning my matter. And because of truly, they don't get correct evidence or concrete evidence, the evidence that will prosecute me. That's why if I go to court, the prosecutor, the way he wants, it is so he talk.
My brother, Fuji, me come out for Jesus. When I met me, how you know, about anymore.
Khalidu says with almost 8 years in this prison without any evidence to prosecute him, he believes only a divine intervention can get him out of his confinement. Khalidu is looking forward to the day he will stop thinking about his predicament.
To go and marry, a wife, born a child, and kill him, even that thing itself, if they say somebody did me, I can't understand, unless the person is not normal. If not a normal person, how can you do that thing? Now, are you destroying yourself or what is that? So because of these things, no. That's why if you see me, I'm growing green head. I think, but it's only one thing that makes me sometime, I take everything and give everything to God. And I know that anything that happened in this world, but God knows. And if truly God knows that I am not the one, and God knows that I can never do that thing, and God knows me, and if it is true that I am not a bad person, the God that created heaven and hell, I know that he will do something concerning me. But in my prayers, I know that maybe it is some of the prayers now working, and now my prison officers and you people now coming asking some of them, and I know that if God want to do favor me or favor some of us or all of us here, it will pass through somebody before we are free here. And I know that by the grace of God, it will surely come because I believe in God.
So what at all could be the reason Khalidu's case has not been determined close to 8 years? That is the question I asked the Director General in charge of legal and prosecutions of the Ghana Police Service, ACP Frank Kofi.
A murder case goes through a certain process. When the docket is prepared from the police station, it must go to the Attorney General's office for advice. As much as the Attorney General wants to advise on this docket as quickly as possible so that the prosecution should start, because of their own constraints, which are genuine constraints, some of these dockets don't come as early as we expect. The fact of the matter is that some of these dockets for advice can stay at the Attorney General's office for 1 year or 2 years, you know. And when the docket comes, it must start from where we call the indictment process, which starts at the magistrate court, and that also takes some time before it is referred to the High Court for prosecution.
ACP Kofi, however, admits at times the police can be faulted in these delays.
Police officers may be at fault. Sometimes police officers who are investigators don't manage their cases properly. Some of them may be transferred from their original station and hand over the docket to somebody who may not follow up the case. Or he may go on UN mission and hand over the docket to somebody who may not follow up the case with the interest that he's supposed to show in that particular case. So there are a lot of issues that can contribute to somebody remaining on remand for quite a long time.
Well, not only men find themselves in the confines of our prisons either on remand, but as prison officials will confirm, the female population is growing, although it's far less than the male population.
Good morning, madam.
Good morning.
8 female prisoners in safe custody, ready for your inspection. May I have your kind permission to carry on?
Carry on.
Yes, madam.
The female prison looks like a boarding house with strict boarding house mistress who sees to it that no one litters. It is very clean and the air here, as compared to the male area, smells better. Prison officers here have resolved to ensure that any female suspect or convict who comes here leaves with at least some basic book knowledge.
You. V-W-S-Y-Z. Clap hands for her.
49-year-old Ia Faustina is among the 8 inmates in the female prison being taught how to read and write. Auntie Ia, as she prefers to be called, has been in this prison for close to 4 years. She lived at Bole, a town in the northern region, and she had 7 children. Until Auntie Ia was brought to this prison, she had a mental problem which often made her sleep outside home or in the bush for weeks.